In front of the canteen, the supporting restaurant of the NMMV, we now have a new vehicle, one of the largest American self-propelled guns ever made, the Howitzer Heavy Self-Propelled 8-inch M110 A2. Today, I'm going to dive into the history of this heavy weapon. In 1955, the U.S. Army was set to make many of its vehicles air-transportable, meeting the needs for their changing doctrine, which focused heavily on air mobility. In January of 1956, a feasibility study was approved to determine the characteristics of an air-transportable heavy artillery. That following September, the Pacific Car and Foundry Company held meetings to design such a platform. Following this, Pacific Car and Foundry, PCF, was awarded the contract from the Army to produce 6 pilot vehicles. These pilot models consisted of the T-235, a 175mm self-propelled gun, the T-236, which was an 8-inch self-propelled howitzer, and the T-245, a 155mm self-propelled gun. These pilot models all shared the same gun mount and chassis, which allowed ease of production and flexibility on the battlefield. 2 of the 3 pilot models would make it into production, the T-235 and the T-236, respectively evolving into the M107 and M110. By 1962, production for the 2 pilot models began at the PCF plant in Renton, Washington. Later, both the Food Machine Corporation, FMC, at their San Jose plant, and the Bowen McLaughlin York, BMY, in York, Pennsylvania, entered the production program. The hull of the M110 is short and lightweight, featuring no more than 1/2 inch of armor. This gave the vehicle a combat weight of 58,500 pounds. The hull was on a torsion bar suspension system using 5 road wheels and gave it a ground pressure of 11.6 psi. Powering the vehicle is a Detroit diesel 8V-71T engine built in Redford, Michigan. This 8-cylinder, 2-stroke engine was turbocharged, liquid-cooled, providing 405 horsepower at 2,300 RPM and 980 foot-pounds of torque at 1,700 RPMs. Coupled to this engine was the Allison Division XTG-411-2A cross-drive transmission with 4 forward and 2 reverse gears. The M110 had a maximum forward speed of 34 miles per hour and a maximum reverse speed of 7 miles per hour. It could climb grades as high as 60%. It could ford through 42 inches of water and climb over walls 40 inches in height. The M110 had a 260-gallon fuel capacity. With its 1.3 miles per gallon average fuel consumption, it could cruise upwards of 325 miles. While the power pack of the M110 is certainly interesting, it's likely not what first catches your attention. That most likely goes to the barrel of the 8-inch howitzer, which on this one behind me comes from the M201A1 artillery. Now, let's talk about why the military wanted this large of a gun to begin with. From the outset, Army-filled artillery doctrine envisioned a self-propelled weapon able to deliver atomic firepower. The M110 was a clear vehicle for that mission. It could fire purpose-built nuclear projectiles, with later variants utilizing M422A1 nuclear and M753 nuclear, giving commanders a credible deployable nuclear option integrated with conventional fire plans. These rounds had a range of 9 miles, or an extended range of 18 miles with a rocket-assisted motor. The earlier M422 had a yield of 5 to 40 kilotons, and the later M753 ranged from a few hundred tons to 2 kilotons. There was no equivalent nuclear round for the 175mm gun seen on the M107. Put simply, if the new common carriage was to satisfy both conventional and nuclear demands, one of its tubes had to be an 8-inch. Nuclear-capable rounds were not the only projectiles the M110 could fire. It sported a wide range of ammunition, from chemical warheads such as M426, M404, which dispensed 104 grenades for area denial, and standard high-explosive M106, with everything else in between. These projectiles had an average muzzle velocity of over 1,900 feet per second and a maximum range of nearly 18,400 yards. Most of these rounds also had different fuse options, allowing flexible usage. Fuse options from point detonating to variable timed multiplied the versatility of these warheads. So while the alternative option, the M107, had further range, the M110 had flexibility and sheer destructive capabilities. As you can imagine, the projectiles for an 8-inch howitzer are incredibly heavy and large. The 8-inch ammunition can weigh anywhere from 230 to 260 pounds. This means that the M110 can only carry 2 rounds of ammunition and relies on ammunition carriers to keep the gun fed. Vehicles such as the M5 Foray were utilized for this role. This also means that the howitzer was not entirely manually loaded. It also had to rely on a semi-automatic loading system to assist in the process. This loading system would swing over, align with the breech, pick up an 8-inch round, put it in line with the breech, and then a hydraulic system pushed the round inside. One of the M110's crew would then put the powder charges on the system, and they'd be pushed inside as well. A well-trained crew could fire as quickly as 2 to 4 rounds per minute. To the rear of our M110, we also find this loading system as well as the controls for it. You may also wonder what this massive spade is for. When the M110 would fire, the recoil would cause the vehicle to move backwards. To help negate this movement, this spade would be dropped, dug into the ground, and prevent the M110 from moving when firing. We could also spot the various crew positions, which the M110 has a lot of, as there are over 13 crew total. The only enclosed crewman is the driver. He sits beside the power pack for the M110. And all things considered, it's a fairly comfortable spot. While it is narrow, it's also tall, so for a tall guy such as myself, it's fairly nice. The driver will be moving the vehicle and performing any maintenance it may require. To the front of the driver, we can also find his various controls and instrument panels, steering bar, accelerator pedal, hand throttle, as well as the multiple instrument gauges in front and to the side of him. The rest of the crew are all outside with no protection. The lead crewman is the chief of section, or CS. The CS is a non-commissioned officer in command of the section, and as such is responsible for the battery and the people beneath him. The CS will oversee all training of personnel and is responsible for the section, drill, tests, and various other jobs that are all listed in FM6-94. The gunner lays the piece for direction while the assistant gunner sets and holds the ordered elevation. On the left side of the breech is the gunner's position. To his right are both the powered and manual traverse systems, and the cutout for where the M115 telescope would usually sit at. On the right of the breech is the assistant gunner's position. To his left are both the manual and powered elevation controls, as well as the cutouts for the M139 telescope. The loading team is built around 8 numbered cannoneers. Number 1 operates the powered loader rammer, number 2 works the breech, inserts the primer, fires on command, and swabs the chamber. Number 3 and 4 handle the projectile, strapping it to the loading tray, attaching and returning tray. Number 5 fuses and sets times or impact as ordered. Number 6 emplaces aiming posts and assists with ammunition prep. Number 7 and 8 assemble the propelling charge to the specific increment and carry to the breech, calling out on the charge. Typically, 5 crew ride on the gun: the chief, the driver, gunner, assistant gunner, and the cannoneer number 1, and the rest ride with the section vehicle. The section vehicle driver operates the ammunition carrier, usually an M5 48, ferries the remaining crew and rounds, and assists as directed. Shortly after its introduction into the US military, the M110 would see its first major action, the Vietnam War. The first M110s would enter Vietnam accompanied the 1965 artillery buildup, and by early 1966, the in-country structure already included several 8-inch battalions. These battalions were quickly thrown into fire bases to provide fire support. From these fire bases, the M110 could provide unmatched firepower in a range of roles. One of the most successful was counter-battery. When these fire bases or units came under Viet Cong artillery attacks, M110s could counterattack, laying down 200-pound high explosive shells with pinpoint accuracy, destroying the opposing artillery and fortifications. The M110 was one of, if not the most accurate, field artillery in all of Vietnam. Major General David Ewing Ott called the M110, quote, the most accurate weapon in the field artillery. The M110 also proved useful when these fire bases came under attack. These heavy howitzers could be used in direct fire scenarios, utilizing beehive or flechette rounds to saturate an area that was being attacked by enemy forces. However, these rounds could be avoided. If an enemy soldier was laying in a defilade or hiding behind a solid structure, these beehive rounds would not be as effective. So howitzer crews adopted a new strategy, killer. Killer Junior for smaller guns such as the 155mm, and Killer Senior for howitzers such as the M110. This killer strategy had gun crews arm a high explosive round with a timed fuse, arming the round to explode shortly after being fired, typically within 200 to 1,000 yards. This caused the round to explode above the enemy, meaning that any cover they had no longer protected them. The M110 served faithfully in the Vietnam War, being one of, if not the greatest artillery of that conflict. This, however, was not without issue. To improve the firing range of the M110, a modernization program started in 1969. This resulted in a new longer tube, which resulted in higher velocities and further range, as well as a new gunner sight to compensate for the higher velocities. This modernization program would conclude in March of 1976 with a standardization of the M110A1, and the following year the M110A1 would enter service. While this program did result in the M110A1 achieving a further firing range, it was not perfect. The longer gun tube paired with a no-muzzle brake meant that the vehicle had massive recoil. The M110A1 could not fire at certain elevations with higher charges. This hampered the vehicle's combat effectiveness. So, not even a year after it entered service, the M110A1 would undergo changes, eventually leading to the M110A2. The M110A2 utilized a modified version of the M110A1's howitzer, featuring a double baffle muzzle brake. This alleviated a lot of the recoil issues, allowing the howitzer to perform its job as intended. And by 1981, all of the M107s and M110A1s in the US Army and Marine Corps were converted to the M110A2 standard. In addition to the new howitzer, the M110A2 would mount two new kits to upgrade the various subsystems to help with the stress from the immense recoil. According to Know Your 8-Inch Howitzer, a U.S. Army publication from August of 1984, two new retrofit kits were developed and installed worldwide on all 8-inch weapons. The retrofit kits, kits 1 and 2, upgraded 20 systems/subsystems of the vehicle. The transformed M110A2 became a significantly more reliable vehicle than before, even when severely tested at Fort Sill, Oklahoma, firing predominantly maximum range. These upgrades affected nearly every system and subsystem of the M110A2, from auxiliary drive mag clutches to relays and everything else in between. Our M110 is an A2 variant, so the last version of this 8-inch howitzer. Its serial number is 331. It was manufactured by the Bowen McLaughlin York at its Bear factory in York, Pennsylvania, and was delivered to the U.S. Army in 1978. The gun tube was also manufactured in 1978, this time by the Watervliet Arsenal in New York. Its serial number is 6601. While we don't know for certain, it is possible that this M110A2 served in Spain. The reason we are suggesting this is because some of the control panels are written in Spanish. 64 M110A2 served in Spanish divisional fire support regiments up until 2009. The last major conflict that the M110A2 was used in, at least in American service, was the Gulf War. After Iraq invaded Kuwait on the 2nd of August 1990, the U.S. began the Desert Shield buildup. The first M110A2s were sent over with the 75th Field Artillery Brigade, which deployed to Saudi Arabia in September of 1990. Not only were American M110s present during this operation, but so were other nations such as Britain, which fielded M110s with the 32nd Heavy Regiment Royal Artillery, which deployed with the UK's 1st Armored Division. The museum's M110A2 has a paint scheme inspired by the Gulf War. We can also see some of the markings that were present on coalition vehicles during this time. On the front fenders of our M110A2, we can also find its unit markings. On the right fender, we see the markings for the 1st 623rd Field Artillery, which is a part of the Kentucky National Guard. The markings on the left fender are indicative of this being the 21st vehicle of the A Battery. Around the howitzer, notably on the barrel, we find invasion chevrons. Upward-pointed arrows were found on most coalition vehicles. They were utilized to identify friendly vehicles and hopefully prevent friendly fire scenarios. If these chevrons were facing any other direction, they would be unit markings. A chevron pointed left would be 1st Platoon, pointing up 2nd, pointing to the right 3rd, pointing down 4th. The 2- or 3-digit number beside the chevrons would tell you what brigade, battalion, and company is a part of. Vehicles with 00 or no numbers usually indicated that they were HQ vehicles. During this time, the M110A2 performed similar jobs as to what they did in Vietnam: bombardment of enemy positions, interdiction, and counter-battery operations. It did these jobs well. However, with the platform pushing nearly three decades of service, it was starting to show its age and falling behind other more modern platforms, such as the M109A3. While vehicles such as the M109 carried a smaller round, advancements in technology meant that they could fire farther and more accurately. These platforms were more ergonomic, mobile, flexible, and outperformed the M110A2 in nearly every category. The M110A2 was also starting to suffer in reliability, some of the faults laid in the design of it, and others not. One issue that I've seen while reading over the reports of the M110A2 were the amount of issues surrounding quality control, parts breaking down before they should or not functioning at all. Some examples of this are poor part quality accounting for 29% of idler arm failures and poor bonding of the rubber on the road wheels accounting for 20% of the failures. With that in mind, the largest issue most of the time was not the vehicle, nor the poor quality control in the parts. It was the crew. Amongst the same documents, most breakdowns or failures were caused by the crew. Quote, improper driver operation accounted for 43% of the idler arm occurrences, and improper installation and removal procedures of the radiator accounted for 32% of the radiator failures. And my personal favorite statistic from this paper, the most common battery failures. More than 10% of the time, the master switch would accidentally be left on, draining the battery. In the late summer of 1994, the M110A2 would be retired, bringing 31 years of service to a close, ending the story of one of America's greatest artillery pieces.